Good morning and welcome to East Newton Baptist Church on this glorious, glorious Easter morning. As your way of finding your way into your seats, we do have a couple of announcements we'd like to preview you to. The first thing I'm going to do, I'm going to give you a little bit of a heads up. Later in the service, you may hear words similar to "He is risen," to which you will respond, "He is risen indeed." Some of you were here for the sunrise service and you already caught that bit of helpful advice. So again, if you hear, "He is risen," this might just work. Nice. Y'all are good at this. All right, so hopefully everybody got a bulletin. I know that we were starting to run a little low. So if you didn't get one, look on with a neighbor, share. We are a nice and inviting church, and we will gladly share with you some of these things. And so a couple of things I would like to point out. I'm not going to look at everything. I do want to let you know that there are some schedule changes for this week coming up for spring break. There will not be regular scheduled activities during this week. The only thing that will happen as normal will be a prayer meeting and the Bible studies that happen. So for youth, y'all pay attention. I'll send you some information. For children, Team Kids, thank you, is not going to be going on this week. And so just be ready for that. We will have regular Sunday worship and Sunday school next Sunday, but during the week, regular activities will be canceled, as well as Wednesday night supper for those that are going to be there. Then another thing I want to address this morning is we are in the midst of our Annie Armstrong North American Missions offering, our Easter offering. This is one of the greatest ways we can contribute to the overall delivery of the good news to the people who need to hear it in North America. We've set a goal of $3,500. I have no doubt that we will not only meet this expectation and this goal, but we will exceed it. At this point, we're at just under 2,000, so we've got a little ways to go, but I know this church, and I know we are all wonderful giving people, and we want this message to be spread, so keep praying about it and being a part of that so we can share the message of Christ. I do want to draw quick attention that we do have quarterly church conference coming up April 18th, and you can read exactly to what that is and what it will entail, and be ready for that information coming up. Starting in a couple of weeks, you guys will have an opportunity to see what it is to act like men. It's a Bible study that will happen for 6 weeks starting April 8th at 5 p.m. here at the church. Cost is about $13 for the book. Today is the day to sign up. If you have not signed up for that yet, do so before you leave. It's going to be a fascinating study led by Dennis Fowler facilitating, but make sure you get a chance to look at that. The other thing I want to say is we have started out worshiping God in a powerful way today. At 7:15, we had our sunrise service with almost 110 people in attendance, which is amazing. What's even more amazing is that the vast majority of them stayed, and for Sunday school, we had about 175 in Sunday school. And what's even crazier is in the back, there are men bringing in chairs for people to sit in. God is in this place. And so now let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship.
Let me ask you to stand as we join together singing, "He Lives."
And just the time I need him, he's all Rejoice, rejoice, O Christian, lift up your voice and sing. Eternal hallelujah to Jesus Christ the King, the hope of all who seek Him, the help of all who find. Not other is so loving, so good and kind. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along my narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You
risen. Almost. Almost. We'll do it again in just a minute when you least expect it. He is risen. All right, there we go. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. We're entering into 40 days of prayer for East Newnan Baptist Church. And I passed these out last week. Our deacons passed them out. We have a few left in the foyer. So on your way out, pick one out up. We'd like for you to join in 40 days of prayer. Each day we'll be specifically praying for something focused on the church and the ministry. It does not mean you can't pray for other things. It does not mean you can't pray for everything on the list. But that day, be sure to pray for whatever's listed, and we can focus our hearts together, because I find when we pray together, God does great things. Nothing that God will do in this church will happen without first being bathed in prayer. So grab one of these sheets and join us in prayer. Today begins the 40 days of prayer. And so I'll just want to go over the things we'll be praying for this week to offer a little clarity. And every Sunday for the next few weeks, I'll go over the ones we're going to be praying for. Today we're praying for an outpouring of God's Spirit upon this church. Now we know God is always present, amen? God is everywhere present. But we also know that God sometimes shows up in a powerful way and shows out his power. And that's what we're praying for in the life of East Newnan Baptist Church. Tomorrow, I'm going to ask you to begin a time of prayer for personal situations in your own life. For we can't even hope to approach God and ask him to do something in this church unless we first ask him to cleanse us. And so we're going to begin with the time of personal confession and repentance on tomorrow, personal humility on Tuesday. On Wednesday, unity in thought. That means that God will direct our thoughts in the same way. God will direct our understanding of the world that we live in the same way, that our thoughts would be his thoughts, that his thoughts would be our thoughts, and we would be walking according to his way. Unity in planning. As we move forward and figure out what God wants us to do right here in this church and in this community, that we would be unified in what he's calling us to do. That God would lead all of us to the same ideas about how we move forward and the same planning. Unity in action, that we act together, that we act as a unit, that we act as a church that's moving forward for the glory of God in his will and his way and his actions. And then unity in purpose, unity in purpose. And we'll be talking about what that purpose will look like over the next several weeks as we come to God for our worship time. So I want to invite you to join with me at this altar this morning, and in just a moment we're going to go to the Lord in prayer for an outpouring of God's Spirit on this church. So join with me on the altar at this time.
Lord Jesus, you knew me when I was still in my mother's womb. You knew me when I rebelled against you, Father. You knew me when you went back to Jerusalem to face certain death. You You knew me when you prayed in the garden for God's will to be done. You knew me when you told Peter to put away his sword. You knew me when you were silent at your trial. You knew me when they yelled, "Crucify him." You knew me when your skin was torn from your flesh as you were beaten. You knew me when they nailed you to the cross. You knew me when you took your last breath on that cruel cross. Yes, you knew me when I was still in my mother's womb. Praise be to God that you were not left in the tomb, that God the Father saw fit to raise you from the dead and make a way for eternal life for all who believe. Even though I rebelled against you, Jesus, you died for me. Holy Spirit of God, I pray that today will be a new day in all of our lives, that you would descend upon this place, that you will pour out today upon this group of believers, that we will be faithful today in a new beginning at your church, that today will be the day of salvation for thousands. And in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Well, welcome once again. We want to welcome each and every one of you. If you're our guest today for the first time or the first time in a long time, we'd like to say we're glad you're here and glad you've chosen to be a part of this worship together with us. We'd like for you to take a connection card in your bulletin, fill it out, and drop it in the offering plate when it goes around so that we can record your attendance. Also, there's some information for some spaces there for information and comments that you might want to leave us or ask about our church, and we'll try to get back to you as quick as possible. Also, there is a group of folks that are committed to come out and visit you and bring you a special gift of some banana nut bread today, I believe. And so you definitely want to fill out one of those if you want to get some good bread. Homemade, they brought it today. That's good stuff. So fill one of those out so that we can record your attendance. Well, are you happy to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Say amen.
Amen.
He is risen. All right, let's stand up. Let's join in fellowship one with another. Tell somebody you love them.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to come to your house this morning. We're so thankful that you sent your son Jesus to be our Savior, to die on that cross for our sins. He'll pardon me. And for his resurrection on that third day. Lord, I know he lives because I know he lives in my heart. And he lives in the heart of all our believers. Lord, I'm so thankful for this church, for you sending Pastor Anthony our way, for all the blessings that you'll bestow upon this church if we just believe in you and follow your guidance, Lord. He is risen indeed, Lord. We love him so much. Lord, we just ask that you take this offering and use it for the furtherment of your kingdom. Lord, we just give him back a portion to you, which you've given to us. Lord, we know we can never outgive your love and your mercy. But we just ask that you use it for the furtherment of your kingdom. I ask these things in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Rose to life that day. There.
Bible tells us that Jesus has the name above all names. Let me ask you, stands, we join together singing, what a beautiful name it is.
Now revealed in Jesus.
Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we come before you today knowing that your name is great, knowing that it's a wonderful name, it's a powerful name, it's a name above all names. And Father, our hope that is in today, in this worship service, we will bless your name. Our hope that every heart, every mind, every thought, every life in this building this morning lays aside the problems of this world, the burdens of their lives, the troubles of the day, and just blesses your name. May God, this be a time where we are refreshed in you, where we are focused on you, where we are honoring you, where we are worshiping you, where our lives are a very testimony of the greatness of your name. For Father, once we were lost, but now we're found. Once we were blind, but now we see. Once we were without hope, but now we have a hope that is above all hopes. We have a future that is above all futures. We have a future with you. And Father, there may be someone today here who does not know that hope, who does not know that Savior, who does not know that life transformation. But we pray, God, that through this word today, through this wonderful worship we've had today thus far, that that person comes to know you as Savior. Father, we give this moment to you. We give this hour to you. But more than that, Father, we give our lives to you. So, Father, just use this time, the reading and the study of your word, to honor your name. In Jesus' blessed and wonderful name, amen. Turn with me in your Bibles to John chapter 2 and verse 18. John chapter 2 and verse 18. I believe every Christian knows the importance of Easter Sunday, the importance of our Easter services. We come together today to celebrate the glory of the resurrection. And we know that God displayed in that moment the power, his glorious power over death, over sin, over our penalty. And he displayed that power in a way that he dealt with the brokenness that is in the world, that he dealt with the sin that's in the world, and that through that death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, we know that one day all the problems in this world will go away. One day all the tears in this world, all the suffering in this world, all the disease in this world will one day go away. All the evil in this world will one day go away, and we have that hope that is in the power of the glory of the resurrection. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, Paul teaches about the power of the resurrection, and it comes down to this when he says in verse 54, when the perishable puts on the imperishable, the mortal puts on the immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where's your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory in our Lord Jesus Christ. The resurrection is the power of God over death. The resurrection is the power of God over death. The resurrection is the power of God over death. He is risen. We're going to participate here, folks. And it is the reason for our hope. It's the reason we can smile when we're going through a tough time. It's the reason we can rejoice when we're in pain. Today, we're going to look at a passage of Scripture in which Jesus foretells his death and resurrection. What's interesting about this particular passage of Scripture And you may be saying, oh, we're doing a Easter service from John chapter 2. That seems pretty early on, doesn't it? But what's interesting about this passage of Scripture is both the context which prompted Jesus to predict his death, and then the role that that information that he gives them plays in his cause for action. Let me say that again. What's interesting is there's a context that causes him to predict his death and burial and resurrection. But there's also an interesting cause for that prompted his actions and why he spoke that. And so let's just look at this passage of Scripture that comes immediately following when Jesus cleanses the temple. And it included a question of Jesus and his authority from the temple authority. So John chapter 2, verse 18. Stand with me in honor of the reading of God's word. John chapter 2, verse 18. So the Jews said to him, "What sign do you show us for doing these things?" And Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews then said, "It has taken 46 years to build this temple, and you will raise it in 3 days?" But he was speaking about the temple of his body. When therefore he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the Scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you, Lord, for this word of Scripture. We thank you, God, for what it means to our hearts. We thank you, God, for what it will teach us today about Christ, about his power, about his resurrection, about his death, about all the things that he came to accomplish to do. And Father, we pray, God, that you will use this information that we learned today to transform us, to change our lives, and to save someone from their dead life. Now, Father, we give this to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Let's back up just a little bit and look at the situation that prompted Jesus to the authorities to ask him these words and prompted Jesus' response here. What's going on here is Jesus comes to Jerusalem, he goes into the temple, and he sees what has happened in the temple is that it's become more of a marketplace than it has been a place of worship. Let me read for you verse 13 in that same chapter of Scripture. The Passover of the Jews was at hand, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Verse 14, in the temple he found those who were selling oxen and sheep and pigeons and money changers sitting there. And making a whip of cords, he drove them out of the temple and the sheep and the oxen, and he poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. And he told those who sold the pigeon, take these things away. Do not make my father's house a house of trade. His disciples remembered what was written, zeal for the house will consume me. Notice that this is not simply a small group of people selling something in the temple. What's going on is the temple was a very important, centrally located part of the worship for the Jews. And they came for the time of Passover to offer these sacrifices. And there they came, ready to worship. And some, when they came there, would have to purchase their sacrifice when they came. For example, maybe they didn't have a lamb or a pigeon or whatever it was needed for their offering. And so they would purchase it when they got there. That was not necessarily what the problem was here, that they were purchasing these things. It's a good thing that they were bringing these things to sacrifice in the temple. And sometimes they would have to change their money so they could purchase these things. That was not necessarily a bad thing. And it is possible that some of these money changers were overcharging the people. But that's not the real issue here. What the real issue is that the temple was meant for worship, not for being a marketplace. What the real problem is here is that they had made the house of the Lord, the temple, where it was a meeting place where God's manifest presence was there and he would meet with the people of God. This was the meeting place of God and man. And they had gone in there and made it into a marketplace. And you could think of all the things that were going on there. They had all these animals in there, and think about all the noise that animals make. All the smells animals make. And we know that there was already blood flowing in the temple from the sacrifices, so there was all that commotion going on. So it's very distracting to the worship that was taking place there. And so what had gone on here is that Jesus walked in and saw the meeting place between his father and his father's people turned into something that it was not intended to be, and the people were not really worshiping God with all their hearts. And he was upset about it. So upset, and a lot of times we think about Jesus just got mad and went in there and reacted. No, here's a guy who contemplates what he does. He made a whip out of cords. That means he braided it together. He took a little time. I can just imagine Jesus sitting down there, braiding that up, saying, I'm going to get these guys out of here. It's something he thought through, you know. And so then he drove them out, turned the money over, spilled it on the floor. A lot of times we think of Jesus as this, you know, this passive man who willingly laid down his life for his people. But his passion for the Lord and his glory is, you can almost taste it here. You see that he is passionate about God and what he's doing. And he didn't want to see that system of worship that was meant to foreshadow the greatest sacrifice that would ever be given, his own sacrifice. He did not want to see that turned into something that it was not. Religion. God never meant for his people to come to him in religious activity. And you may be here today and you say, well, I don't really like all this organized religion. Well, good. That's not what Christianity is supposed to be. Christianity is supposed to be about a relationship. Christianity is supposed to be the God of the universe becoming flesh and coming to die so we could have a relationship with him. It's about a relationship. It's about a relationship with God. It's about a relationship with other people. That's what Christianity is all about. And sometimes, do you know that we make Christianity into something it's not, and the Jews had made Jewish faith into something it was not supposed to be? It was about the activity and not about the God behind the activity. And that's what Jesus was upset about. He was upset that they were simply going through the religious motions and not meeting the God of the universe. And I think he could come into all of our churches today at some point or another and say the same thing to us. So he braided his whip and he got busy driving out the oxen and the sheep from the temple area, said, get it out of here. I think he would have been okay with them setting up right outside the temple. You know, I don't think he'd have a problem with that. But get it out of my father's house and let's do what we're supposed to do in here, meet God. Do you know what this passage of Scripture suggests? That Jesus has the authority to drive out these money changers from God's temple. And guess what else? Jesus has the authority to speak truth into your life. Why are you here today? I just want to ask everybody to think about that. Why are you here today? You may say, well, I always come to church. That's why I'm here today. That's just what my family does. I think that's honorable. Why are you here today? Is it because you're visiting family and you're here with them today? Well, we're glad to have you. Why are you here today? Are you here today because it's Easter and you think it's important to be in church on Easter? I think you're right. It is important to be at church on Easter and every other Sunday of the year too. But we're glad you're here. We're glad you're here on Easter because it is the most important Sunday of the year for Christian people. Why are you here today? Are you here because you have nowhere else to turn? Are you here because your life is in shambles and this is a last-ditch effort to figure out what's going on? Are you here today because you don't know what to do? Let me just tell you something. You've come to the right place. Because whatever your problem is, Jesus is the answer. Whatever difficulty you're going through, Jesus will fix your situation. Now, he won't take you out of your situation, but he will help you go through it. Jesus is the answer. So you've come to the right place. Regardless of why you're here this morning, I want you to listen. I want you to really listen. What's going on in your life? Are you broken? Are you hurt? Are you lost? Are you unsure where to go? Have you just been going through the motions? Whatever you're here this morning, I want you to really think that Jesus here has the answer to your problems and the resurrection proves it. In our text today, we see three truths about the resurrection that provide us with the hope that Jesus has authority over this world, over the Jewish faith, over the Christian faith, over every single human being that's ever been born, over the city of Newnan, he has authority, over East Newnan Baptist Church, and over your life, he has authority, and the resurrection proves it. The first thing we see is that the resurrection was the plan from the beginning. Look at verse 19, if you will. And Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews who confronted Jesus here are either temple authorities or representatives of the ruling council, the Sanhedrin, or maybe they're both. We're not exactly sure who they were, but they had some authority in the temple. And they demand some miraculous sign to justify why Jesus has done what he has just done. Why did you run these people out? Why did you turn the money changers' money over? Why did you do all that? What authority do you have to do these things? And they came to him and they asked him that question. Now, I want you to note something. These people had every right to ask Jesus this question, because they were the ones that were supposed to be in charge of governing the affairs of the temple. It just gone off the rails a little bit. But they didn't know who Jesus was, really. They didn't understand what he was about to do, really. They didn't understand where he had come from. They didn't understand who Jesus was. They had their responsibility to keep order in the temple and preserve what was going on in the temple. They had their responsibility to do that, and they went to Jesus to find out what was up. And their focus was on the religious principles and practices and not on the God who they should have been worshiping. They're not concerned here with right worship. They're concerned here with right procedure. You think we ever get caught up too much in the procedure and not enough in the worship? You think we ever get too caught up in going through the motions and all the traditions and things we associate with the church and not on who God really is? Listen, when we catch wind of who God is and it infects this church, it's going to reach out and infect this community. But if, as long as we're focused on the procedures and the legalism and the religious activities and not on the God behind those things, we're never going to reach this community for Christ. D.A. Carson notes that the authorities believed that Jesus was a vagabond or a troublemaker. No, if they had believed that, they would have just thrown him out of the temple. You know, if we had someone come in here that was a drunk or something and causing disruptions, I'm sure we'd have some folks get up and show them the door, right? So if they had believed he was some kind of vagabond or someone just disrupting, they would have just thrown him out. But they must have believed there's something more to this guy, because they went to him and said, "What authority do you have for doing this?" Have you ever thought about that? What authority do you have for doing this? He goes on to note that had the authorities had spiritual eyes, they would have seen the cleansing of the temple was already a sign, and they wouldn't have asked for another one. This was a sign. Jesus was giving a sign that he had the authority to throw these guys out. And then we see that Jesus responds. He says, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." Now, literally, they understood him to be talking about the building that they were in. Because what do we always associate a church with? A building. That's wrong. Y'all don't have earthquakes around here, do you? No. We had to deal with the concern about that over near the Mississippi River. They're always talking about some big earthquake that hit Memphis that's going to come back. So we were always a little concerned about that kind of thing. But we had tornadoes. Y'all have those sometimes. So a tornado could come through tomorrow and tear this building down, but the church would stand, right? Because the church is not the building, it's the people. We learn that as little children, don't you know? Here's the church, here's the steeple, but open the door and there's the people, right? You remember that? If you don't remember it, just think about it. It'll come back to you eventually. We know this. But they thought immediately of this building, you know, this temple that they were in. You tear this temple down and destroy this temple, and I'll rebuild it in 3 days. They're immediate. This, it took 46 years to build this. This guy must be out of his mind. But John gives us a little commentary here, and he says, we know that he was referring to his own body, which is the temple. Think about what that means. Have you ever thought about what it means that Jesus is the temple? You ever thought about that? Jesus is the temple. The temple was the meeting place of God and man. Jesus is Emmanuel, God with us. God met man in the ultimate way by becoming a man and coming to dwell with his people. He descended to us because we could not go to him. We could not do anything to save ourselves, so he descended to us. And so he's referring to himself. And through Jesus' death and resurrection, he would destroy the former works of the temple. You know, the sacrifices that were required over and over and over again, and the Day of Atonement every single year. They had to repeat these things over and over again. But then in the real temple, Jesus Christ, one sacrifice would take place that would rule them all. One sacrifice would do away with all the rest. The bloodless, the guiltless Lamb of God, the blood of Jesus Christ, the sacrifice to end all sacrifices, would be the final and only sacrifice that would ever be needed ever again. And what he's showing here is that the scriptures had always pointed to this. What he's showing here is that before the foundation of the first temple, before the foundation of the second temple was laid, before the death and resurrection of Jesus, God had planned this in eternity past. All of this had been planned in eternity past. Before the tabernacle instructions were given to Moses in the Old Testament, the plan for Jesus' death was in place. Before the very covenant that God made with Abraham, where he said, I will bless you, and I will make you a great nation, and I will give you a promised land, and I will bless all the nations of the earth through you. He had a plan for Jesus, and that was the blessing that would come. Before the very foundations of the world was laid, the plan was in place for Jesus to come. Listen, if you think that somehow Jesus' death on the cross and Jesus coming to the earth was a reaction by God to the sin in the world, then you have totally missed the point. The Bible teaches that the Lamb was slain before the foundation of the world. That when God made a decree in eternity past, before a single molecule of this world, let's take it even deeper, before a single atom of this world was created, God had a plan to send his son Jesus to die on the cross for you and me. There was no plan B. It was always plan A. God is not reacting to our situation. God is ordaining our situation. Did you know that? God has laid out a plan for you and me to be saved. And God is accomplishing that plan in time. The cross was not a reaction. The resurrection was the plan from the beginning. Number two, the resurrection confirms Jesus' authority, the authority of Jesus. Look at verse 18 to 21. So then the Jews said to him, what sign do you show us for doing these things? And Jesus answered, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. And then the Jews said, it has taken 46 years to build this temple, and will you raise it up in 3 days? But he was speaking about the temple of his body. Jesus' response dumbfounded the temple authorities. They had asked for a miraculous sign. And if someone could restore the temple of God in 3 days, that certainly would have been a sign, right? So they asked for a sign, and he gave them one, and then he did it. You see where I'm going with this? So they asked for a sign. He said, I'll destroy this temple and I'll build it in 3 days. They missed the point. And they said, oh, this building took 46 years to build. But he was talking about his own body. And then the sign that they asked for, that he told them he would give them, his own body, it died. And then it was resurrected in 3 days. Glory be to God. The sign was given, and the sign confirms the authority that Jesus had for doing what he did. So the dwelling place of God is Jesus. The temple is Jesus because he is God. In this temple, the ultimate sacrifice would take place. Within 3 days of his death, Jesus would rise again. He is risen. Oh, you almost went to sleep, didn't you? I am keeping my eye on y'all. See, that's how I keep you awake, right? Make you participate. It's not the rebuilding of the brick-by-brick physical temple that Jesus had in mind here. It is that wonderful, amazing sacrifice of his own body on the cross where he took our sins upon his shoulder and died for them. But don't leave him in the cross, because the glorious power of Jesus is not necessarily and only in the death, but it's in the death and the resurrection together. You see, the death paid the penalty. The resurrection conquered death. Isn't that good? Y'all didn't seem like it was very good. Y'all still asleep? He is risen.
He is risen.
Okay, there you go. That's much better. We're going to get this. Jesus walked out of the tomb, and when he did, he proved that without a doubt he was God, he was creator, he was savior, and that he has all authority on heaven and earth. That he is the creator of the universe, the sustainer of the universe, and that he is the savior of the world, and that he is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And if Jesus is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, as the resurrection confirms, then he is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords of your life, whether you agree with him or not. So it would just do you well to agree with him. It will work out much better for you in the end if you do. He has authority over your life. He has the authority to speak truth in your life. And you say, well, you know, the Bible just, it doesn't seem relevant in my life. You want the best plan for your life? It's right here. You want to know how to overcome all the obstacles that you face in this life? It's right here. You want to know how to face the difficulties that you have in this world, the cancer, the sickness, the diseases, the whatever. Lots of knee and hip replacements and back surgeries going on in all the people I know in my life these days. You want to know how to face those things? You got to face them with Jesus. He is there with you and for you, and he has the authority to speak truth in your life. And so you must live for him, and you must submit to his authority. The resurrection confirms the authority of Jesus. Lastly, the resurrection is the basis of our faith. Verse 22, when therefore he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus has spoken. Y'all know why we're here today? Because of the resurrection. You know why we'll be here next Sunday? Because of the resurrection. You know why we'll be here the next Sunday? Because of the resurrection. You know why we'll be in heaven? Because of the resurrection. The resurrection is the basis of our faith. If the resurrection didn't happen, we have no business being here. We might as well just go eat. Now, don't lose me here. Don't think about your lunch right now. The resurrection is everything. That's why this day is so important. That's why it's my favorite holiday of the year. Because it is through the power of the resurrection that I have power in my life. It's through the power of the resurrection that one day I'll get out of the grave. And it's through the power of the resurrection that you can be saved. Because of all those things that Jesus did, because he did what he said he would do, because he rose from the dead, we can trust all the other claims that he made. So he said he would be raised from the dead. He was raised from the dead. Everything else he says is true. He said, I'm the bread of life. He said, I'm the good shepherd. He said, I'm the Son of God. He said, before Abraham existed, I am. He's saying there, I always existed. Without the resurrection, Jesus would be just another teacher, just another man, just another Jew. But the resurrection provides all the proof we need that Jesus is the Lord over all creation and the Savior of our souls. In the garden with Adam, everything that mankind had been given was lost. Our sinless hearts, our God-centered minds and lives, our intimate relationship with God. And when Adam sinned, everything spiraled out of control. The world was broken. The world is broken. We look around at the world and we see evil, and we see sickness and death at every turn. Everything was broken. Our relationship with God is broken. And in Romans chapter 8, we find that all creation is longing, like the pains of childbirth, for redemption. In just 3 days, Jesus rebuilt everything that was lost in the garden. In just 3 days, Jesus put it all back together and reconciled all things to God. But Pastor Anthony, you don't know how bad my life really is. You don't know what I'm going through. Yeah, you're right. I don't know. I don't know much. But Jesus knows it all. And he died so that you could be set free. And when he rose from the dead, he defeated sin and death and hell. By what authority does Jesus speak truth into your life? By the same authority that he can govern the affairs of the world. He is God, he's Redeemer, and the resurrection proves it. Now, if you're here this morning and you've never surrendered your life to Christ, I want you to know that Jesus died for you. The Bible says that all are sinners. There's none righteous, not one. There's no one who seeks after God. There's no one who could ever save themselves. There is nothing we can do, no church service we could attend, no amount of Sunday school classes we could teach. You can't even become a pastor to be saved. There's nothing you can do to save yourself. But Jesus, who is God of the universe, wrapped himself in flesh and came to the earth to become a man. He lived a perfect and sinless life, and he died on the cross to take the sins of humanity upon his shoulders. And the Bible says if you just have faith and trust in him and place your faith and authority in him, he will save you from your sin. And he will reconcile you to God, and he will correct all that is wrong with your life. Now, he won't take you out of your bad situation. He won't necessarily heal you of cancer, but he might. But he will be with you in the midst of that, and he will take you into his eternal home forever and ever, where there'll be no suffering and no tears. So I want to ask you today, why are you here? Are you here to meet Jesus? Are you here to find out the answers to life? Jesus is the answer, and he's calling you to be saved today. Father, we come before you today recognizing, Father, that everything that is in us is wicked. That our total person is focused away from you in our lost state. That we are wanting to please ourselves, wanting to do our own thing, but Father, you have another way for us. A life transformation that takes place through the power of the blood of Jesus Christ. And Father, I pray, God, if there's someone here today that's really struggling with what to do about you, that you will reveal it to them in such a powerful way that they need to be saved today. If there's someone here that's struggling with another issue that just needs you to speak truth into their lives, Lord, I pray, God, that you will do a work in their lives. Father, we just want to give this moment to you. We want to ask you to do a powerful work in our lives. And we want to ask you to transform us, Lord, from the inside out as we throw ourselves on the mercy of your cross, on the mercy of your death, on the mercy of your resurrection, and ask you to accomplish the victory in our lives over sin, death, and hell. Take our penalty, O Lord, and save us. In Jesus' name, with your heads bowed and your eyes closed, stand to your feet. Give this moment to God. This is your opportunity to do business with God. If God is working in your heart and you need to be saved, you come right now. You come. Accept Christ as your Savior. If you're here today and you need to do other business, this altar is always open. Bring your burdens to God. There's something about getting out of your seat and coming down front and just giving it to God. This altar is not magical or special, but it's a commitment that we have to come and bring our stuff to you. If you want to join our church, now's your opportunity. This is your invitation. You come. Amen. It's a good day to be in the house of the Lord. He is risen. All right. You come on up, Amy. Uh-oh. You throwing that at me? All right. We have Amy Stewart coming by letter. She desires membership in the church from Raymond Baptist. So everybody say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
I'm glad you're coming. Coming up. And then many of you know this little guy. His name is Hampton Turner, and he's coming by profession of faith, requesting membership in the church by baptism. And so everybody say, praise the Lord. All right. And if you like his tie, say amen.
Amen.
Looking tie, buddy. All right. All right. Well, you come by and extend the right hand of fellowship to these folks as you come by. And as you're celebrating Easter today, every moment of the day, give thanks to God for what he has done. This is a great time to be a part of East Newnan Baptist Church, because I believe God is going to do some magnificent things here. And we're excited y'all are on board with it, all right? All right. So you want to come on up? Stand with us? Yeah, that way you're not by yourself, right? All right. You come on by and extend the right hand of fellowship as we close with a word of prayer. Father God, go with us now as we leave this place. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to sing a song.
Please take the hand of those around you with both of us singing, because you